Hello, everyone. So I think today we're going to have a very interesting presentation by Dr. Lisheng Shao on the performance of ground improvement on the strong earthquake. So I'll keep my introduction short. But Dr. Shao serves as a chief engineer ground improvement for Malcolm Drilling in Los Angeles, California. Dr. Shao is registered as a professional engineer and a geotechnical engineer in North Carolina, California, Hawaii, and as well as Alberta. His main responsibilities with Malcolm Drilling are ground improvement design analysis, quality control, technology development throughout the United States. He has extensive experiences in liquefaction mitigation, soft soil improvement, excavation support, and dam rehabilitation, employing vibro stone columns, soil mixing, jet grouting, micropiles, and groutings. Dr. Shao received his PhD degree in 1995 from North Carolina State University and has published over 60 technical papers in geotechnical engineering. Currently, he's also an active member of ASCE, the Geotechnical Institute, and the Deep Foundation Institute. So without further delay, Dr. Shao, I will let you take the stage. Thank you.
Thank you. Let me share my screen. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, thank you, Tony, for the introduction. And also I can see well. I know University of Alberta in Edmonton for a long, long time. First through Professor Peter Robinson. He's teaching over there, and Peter is a pioneer of the CPD testing. I can say I learned a lot from him during my career for the geotech engineer. And also he taught me the detailed geology in Edmonton, where I do quite some of the project when I work with Keller or Hayward Baker in the past. And I have been working with Hayward Baker, Keller for 24 years, and I moved to Malcolm Drilling early this year. So my topic of today's seminar will be the performance of the ground improvement under strong earthquake. Let's see. Yeah. So I'll start with the outline, a brief introduction of Malcolm Drilling, and I'll talk about what the mechanism of the liquefaction mitigations, especially how we use soil mixing to mitigate this liquefaction and lateral spreading. And also I'll use a case study to see how this ground improvement performance during the real earthquake. Majority of my presentation, you can find from this DFI, this year DFI keynote paper. This is a long paper, 57 pages, co-authored with Professor Boulanger. And also there's some other analysis and also the testing, the related paper you can see from here. They're in Soil Dynamics and Earthquake Engineering in 2018, and also in ASCE Geotech Journal in 2013 and 2014. So that's the foundations of this presentation and also the technical details. Malcolm is a big private owned company working in North America with many offices nationwide. We are mainly focused on the large, sophisticated geotech constructions. We're the second largest contract, the geotech contract in North America, followed Keller. You can see this is of our typical work. This in downtown San Francisco, a big high-rise building, in this earthquake center in the world. Huge earthquake excitation. And we perform this kind of specialty geotech constructions of the deep excavation well below the ground surface, below the work table depths. And you can see we install this groundwater cutoff wall or retaining wall. And also with multi-layer of tieback, dewatering, internal bracing, and also you can see the soil mixing cells, soilcrete cells below that to provide additional vertical support and also the liquefaction mitigations. So we do this called combined geotech specialty construction throughout North America. One of our tools, and also today's topic, is soil mixing. Soil mixing uses this kind of a tools. You can see this single column, large diameter. This large diameter from 3 feet all the way to 11 or even 12 feet. Tied to a heavy drill rig, all this called the triple axial mixing, and also this called the cutter soil mixing. Basically, you can see on the left, mechanically uses a mixing tool to blend the cement slurry or cement powders with the soil and create this soilcrete. It's a low strength cement and blend in situ together with the soil. And this is called column mixing. We introduce a binder, majority of the binder in this slurry type during the penetration. And we finally mix it when we pull out. If we use a dry method, it will be penetration first, and release a binder when we pull out. This cutter post top of the type of the soil mixing provide high quality groundwater cutout panels. Is typically penetrated with grout or bentonite slurry to initially to break the soil, and then finally mix it again when the things pull up. This a panel type of soil mixing. You already do the primary and the secondary pattern. And this kind of a panel can insert the wide flange beam for additional reinforcement. You can see this is application, what we do for the soil mixing. You can see this is a soil mixed panel, use a cutter mixing method, and also with this a vertical wide flange beam for the reinforcement, and also multiple layer of tieback anchors. And also at the bottom, we position this kind of the soil mixing in cellular pattern to mitigate the liquefaction to provide additional vertical support. This is a high-rise building, and we put additional column over there to support its elevator core, which is the center and the center of gravity of the building as well. So this kind of the ground improvement can provide multiple benefit from the excavation support, groundwater cutoff, reduce foundation settlement and enhance the bearing capacity, or we reinforce a slope, improve the slope stability. And also it has been used widely for the liquefaction and the lateral spreading mitigations. And this is kind of a typical layout. You can position that under the roadway embankment, position the things in this kind of discrete columns. The column is individual, not contact each other, but also you can position them in a grid pattern. And all the lattice type of the pattern for the liquefaction stabilization, or you do that for the vertical support. And also you can position that below the building, also different configurations. This is a way people design the soil mixing as a shear panel to provide resistance to stabilize the moving slope. Soil mixing is a unique material. It's more like a low stress concrete. It's very brittle. And you can see this is a plot of the axial strain versus the vector stress. It's a very brittle material. In the unconfined state, unconfined compressive testing, it breaks usually less than 1% of the strain. So it's very brittle. And after it reaches the peak stress, it will quickly drop while we crash this soil grid. It's more like a behavior like a sandstone. In the confined undrained case, there are some significant residual shear stress. Professor Dung, he is did quite some of the research in University of Alberta in Edmonton related to this soil created residual shear stress, as well as its behavior under the freezing and the soil. Typically, you can see from this equation, the shear stress is a function of the unconfined compressive stress. Its shear stress typically 1/2 or 1/3 of its unconfined compressive stress, and also related to this relationship to your strain status and also to its curing. The cement and soil blend together, it takes a longer time to cure. So it develops stress much longer compared to the conventional concrete. Concrete, we use stress on 28 days of the age, but when we do the soil crete, some people use 56 days of the age, sometimes even use longer. And this factor will help you to extrapolate by the day, so you really want to load this soil crete. And also, this soil crete has a significant variable spatial. Because when you're mixing of the different soil layer, different native soil, you will gain the different soil crete stress. So when we design this soil mixing, we always need to have a statistical mind, use the statistics to measure and evaluate this behavior of the soil crete. And the soil crete can be used for liquefaction mitigations. We know liquefaction happens when the loose saturated sand under the earthquake cyclic shear, it starts to densify and squeezes the void filled with water. And under such a cyclic shear, there's a forward pressure buildup. When it cannot drain quickly, it's a forward pressure buildup. And when it reached a certain point, the effective stress dropped to zero and the soil behaved like a heavy fluid. So it's a loss of strength and can trigger a very large deformations. And people usually to plot this relationship, the cyclic shear stress ratio versus the CPT tip resistance or the SPT blow count, and use this envelope to justify. Inside this envelope, consider soil will liquefy. Outside this envelope, from the field observation, also lab testing, we confirm it's not liquefied. So the liquefaction mitigation is basically you try to bring this internal, this a solid dot, move it outside. Yeah, turn the liquefiable soil to non-liquefiable soil. One of the way we call densification. You shake it, you densify it by, vibrostone column method or compaction grouting method. You increase the soil density and bring this dot outside. We call densification. Or we can reinforce it, reduce the cyclic shear stress, take away of cyclic stress applied to soil. Let us take to the soil mixing and reduces the soil cyclic shear stress within the soil to mitigate it, to reduce the risk of the liquefaction. So you can see we can go there's a densification reinforcement. Some people use a drainage. That is one we will not talk over here. It can be used for some simple cases. And also there's some traditional ways. You're hammering the pile down to bypass the liquefiable soil, or we just remove and recompact it. So many ways we can deal with it. Today, I'll be more focused on this ground improvement by the reinforcement. This reinforcement performed by soil mixing. The soil mixing, you can design that in a different way. As I showed before, with a discrete column, each individual column are spatially distributing the soil profile. Many researchers performed before. It started to borrow the concept of the stone column design. Stone column design considered the shear strength compatibility and assumed the stone column take a higher shear and reduce the shear stress within the soil. And later, some of the researchers extrapolate that theory to the soil mixing, that soil mixing column take higher shear. Recently, there's quite some of the researchers you can list over here, try to investigate this soil and the soil-crate interaction. So they run the finite element analysis in 3D, and this is called a half unit cell. Half of the soil mixing column or stone column and half of the soil of its tributary area. And provide this a seismic excitation from the base and analyze its interactions with the soil. So this has been done in UC Davis and led by Professor Boulanger. And they find out actually when you use a discrete columns, there's a strain within the column and the surrounding soil, they're never compatible. So this big discrepancies we plot over here compare of this strain compatibility assumption versus the real 3D finite element analysis. You can see with a different modulus ratio, the modulus ratio of the column itself versus the native soil, especially when you have a high modulus ratio. For example, you're at 30 times your column modulus ratio versus a native soil, you can see it's a huge difference of this reinforcement effect. So this showed from the theory, this discrete column has a relatively less effective in this kind of reinforcement effect. And this strain is not compatible. And also this research has been confirmed through the centrifuge test. The centrifuge test just spin the model and provide this cyclic shear and the base and evaluate the pore pressure and the deformations of the soil in between. The conclusion is it's a minor reinforcement and the soil still observed the liquefaction between this stiff soil mixing columns. And this has been done in UC Davis and also similar observations they found has been performed in Japan. When we use a grid, the interactions of the soils are created significantly improved. This has been investigated of the deep of the detailed finite element analysis. Again, half unit cell and the soil in the middle and confined by the soil crate. And for this kind of the research, we can find in general, this string compatible model is very close to this finite element analysis. There's some difference in the scale, but not as well magnitude of scale difference as we talk about for the discrete columns. So we can see this discrete the soil mixing cell is a more efficient and effective way to confine the soil, even with the same replacement ratio, this grid will behave much better compared to the discrete columns. And there's many other layout, like this shear panel layout configurations or shear grid configurations. This has been used for the dam liquefaction and the lateral spreading mitigation to build up this kind of a soil mixing panels or block to make as a shear key to reduce the dam deformation during the earthquake. And also this model has been evaluated numerically and also through the centrifuge test. You can see this is a simulated shear panel by soil grid and position them in this testing box, spin it and shake it and evaluate the support pressure deformation, the distribution, and also this a dam deformation. So observe this quite effective. This can be used for the engineering practice. The details you can find from the paper I list at the beginning. So we talk about the theory, we talk about the mechanism, we talk about the analysis and also the lab testing. Now we go to the reality. I use this as a case study, as one of the case study to see how effective this ground improvement during the real earthquake. We have a project before in downtown Anchorage. You can see the downtown Anchorage. Here is this Pacific coast along North America from California, Los Angeles, San Francisco. Historically, a lot of the earthquake and also along the shorelines in British Columbia and all the way to Alaska coast. And you can see 55 kilometers away from downtown Anchorage, there was a huge earthquake happens in 1964 called Prince William Sound earthquake, a magnitude 9.2. So it caused severe damage locally and also propagate to Anchorage, caused a severe damage. This project in Anchorage planned to make a bridge over this Alaska Railway, double lane rail, and also Arctic Boulevard, 200 feet bridge span. The soil, you can see the borings, they have a peat layer, and also with this silt layer. You can see on the photo, the peat and the silt. The silt is its natural marsh content even higher than its liquid limit. You can see 25% versus 24%, 34% versus 27%. When this is silt, low plastic or non-plastic, its natural marsh content higher than its liquid limit, under the earthquake cyclic shear, you will quickly lose its shear strength and then cause a liquefaction. And also over here, when we put the roadway embankment over there, it will experience a severe earthquake. So at the site, original geotech design earthquake, still assume the Prince William Sound earthquake happens again at 55 kilometers away. And at this location, this embankment will suffer a 2.67G peak ground surface acceleration. So this is a design base, and we anticipated this silt going to liquefy and lost shear strength. So we plan to do the mitigation because this embankment cannot survive when this soil liquefies. So we just go many iterations and assume what over here we treated and provide a composite shear stress of 4,000 PSF and use this more like a shear block. So during the design, we also see well, this shear block, if we can take this a huge lateral load, we can also take the vertical load. So together work with a bridge structural engineer, we also say there's a depiling approach to a spread footing. Just let this a load of the bridge directly applied to this treated, soil mixing treated block. And then with targeting, we can gain pretty high factor safety together with a combined static and also the seismic load. So from the structural point of view, because structural engineer not feel comfortably directly position their spread footing on top of the liquefiable soil. And well, after back and forth many times, we decided we do this 90% replacement ratio. It's near 100% replacement, and we position the bridge spread footing on top over here. And also we use 50% of the soil mixing as a shear panel to resist this embankment lateral load. So you can see on both sides, the west side and the east side, here is this Alaska Railroad, and also there's a street passing by as well. This is a layout from the contractor side. We do this a very closed space mixing block, 90% replacement ratio, and also this is the shear panels, 50% replacement ratio. And the railroad in the middle, and also there's a water supply tunnel and the ground power line, communication lines, many other utility lines. So we adjust our pattern, try to fit this aside restrictions. And all those columns, the interlocked, overlap the 8 feet diameter soil mixing. We use that to make a shear block and also the shear panels. This kind of treatment work together to take the vertical and also the lateral load from the embankment and bridge. Here is a side photo that's in the summer of 2014. We use one rig for the pre-drill to remove some of the organic soils and push back some of the granite sand material, and followed by the soil mixing. We targeted 200 kilogram of the cement per cubic meter of the soil and the grout. We call the final contact in place. Use a grout or cement ratio 1.2 and specific gravity between 1.42 to 1.44. And this is a batch plant, and what we store is the cement, and then we transfer that to the mixing tub, use jet valve to blend the cement with the water, and holding tank to further blend it and hold it, and use this computer controlled pump, push it to the drill rig and the pumping through the center of the mixing tool, bring it to the ground, and then mechanically through this mixing tool to blend the grout together with the in-situ soils. So this is a computer controlled system, and it's a monitor, there's a binder content in place by measure how much grout getting and how much of the volume we mix it per unit time. And also record this called a BRN blade rotation number. Basically, this is a measurement number is within 1 meter of the soil, how many times this cutting blade cuts through the soil. So we maintain this at least 500 or higher. And also we measure this called the drilling index. Imagine this huge mixing tool, it's an oversized wing shear. So we monitor the hydraulic pressure, interpolated how much of the resistance we gain from the soil. So use this as an additional indicator, compare of the CPTs and make sure we key in to the competent nonlinear dense soil below. And also we retrieve the soil sample when it's wet, put that to the mold, cure them and test them at the 3-day, 7-day, 14-day, 28-day, and 56-day strength. So we can understand how this soil grid gains the strength as a function of time. And also analyze them statistically. So this is a 56-day strength distributions. You can see this is a big curve, a backbone curve, and our design targeting average unconfined compressive strength of 1 MPa, 150 PSI. In reality, this average, we already doubled it. And we have a standard deviation of a 60 PSI. Coefficient of variation is 19%. This is kind of my point in my engineering practice. I always emphasize we analyze this soil grid statistically. Avoid, as I see, a minimum 1 MPa, but when you have one or two data points below it, that does not mean we cannot take the building load. You can see when I have a few data points below, I have so many data points above it. So we always need to have a statistical mind, and then we can do the things practically. Saw mixing finished in August and August 2014, and followed by the embankment, the abutment constructions, MSE work constructions, bridge constructions, and this bridge in operation that's on November 10th, 2015. So after that, we have a real full-size dynamic load test, which is no way we can do that in the lab or simulate it. So a big earthquake, 2018 early morning time, magnitude 7, 12 kilometers north of downtown Anchorage. It's caused significant amount of the damage. You can see over here, there's this kind of the field reconnaissance. The green dot shows the building, there's no damage. The red is caution, the building damaged, but need further inspection. For the red, it's red tape and not supposed to be occupied again after the detailed repair or demolitions. And you can see this damage is a widespread. Our project site is somehow over here. Nearby, you can see quite some of the damage of the surrounding buildings. And also, this is the bridge site, that's more in details. In Alaska, in Anchorage, Alaska, luckily, there's many of this seismic recording station. So 0.7 kilometers away from the bridge, there is a monitoring station, shows a 0.47G as a horizontal acceleration. This is much higher than of our design earthquake, 0.267G. And also it records this particle velocity as well as the accelerations at the different frequencies. So very good field record. And also there's another location not too far away, 1.3 kilometers. There's a bridge embankment. It's like a bridge approach wall was collapsed. And that had been reported in the news media. And the adjacent monitoring station showed 0.29G as a peak velocity. So you can see within this graph, there are quite some different location by location of the site response. So the same earthquake, due to the soil conditions and wave propagation, their acceleration could be totally different. So statistically analyze it, understand the seismic behavior is critical for the bridge design or any of the ground improvement design. So right after earthquake, GEAR they send a reconnaissance team led by Kevin, and also with Army Shuddai. They visit this site and take many of the photos. So their conclusions is a very light structural damage observed. The bridge still in operation, revealed by Alaska DOTs. And there's some of the light buckling, and observe this kind of the I-beam of the girder. There's some of the movement, but anyway, this bridge is in very good condition after the earthquake. And also this MSE wall panel, the gap has some of the deformations as observed, but there's no significant damage of this MSE wall. This MSE wall was partially supported by this soil mixing shear panels. So in conclusion, this ground improvement performed quite well during this earthquake. And this is a very cost-effective solutions. This is the first time Alaska DOT adopt this kind of method for the seismic mitigation. And they use this soil mixing not only to hold the slope lateral movement, but also to take the bridge vertical load. So one ground improvement has multiple gains. And this ground improvement performs well, even it's well exceeded as a design peak ground surface acceleration, partially due to the conservatism in our analysis and also conservatism during the production. The real install of the soil grid has a double the strength of the design intent. So it's performed quite well. So this kind of a good field evaluation to show us and confirm us this analytical model, as well as the detail, the design, the quality controls of the ground improvement itself. I really appreciate all of the help of our research from peer and also California Department of Water Resources and also Alaska DOTs and my Keller colleagues and also the consultants, Kenichi Yamasaki, and also the peer team performed this post-earthquake reconnaissance. And also, for sure, my co-author, Ross Belongi, and also many technical guides from Peter Robinson, previous professor from University of Alberta in Edmonton. And also, thank you for the audience. Any question?
Okay, thank you, Lisheng, for the very interesting presentation. As a reminder to the audience, please, if you have a question, you can type in the chat box and we'll curate all the questions from there. And we do have some time for quite a bit of questions. So please do that. The first question from the audience is about the shear wall. So for that shear wall, how would you compare the shear wall constructed using gravel with those constructed using soil grid in terms of cost and effectiveness? And also, I guess that's two questions. How deep can you install this type of shear wall?
Yeah, this is a very good question. Let's answer the simple side first. The soil mixing can go very deep. So there's a shear wall. If you do by the soil mixing, we can go over 100 feet, let's say 33 meters, to bypass this liquefiable soil and key into the competent bearing layer. Some of the shear resistance, indeed, we can do by gravels or in more popular by stone column. Stone column use a depth vibrator penetrating into the ground. apply this that's an eccentric motor to bring this cyclic shear to the bottom. The shake around causes a local liquefaction, densify the native granular soil, create cavity, and backfill the cavity back gravel. This has been used in many, many of the dam and roadway embankment to stabilize the slope and also to reduce its static and also seismic settlement. Yeah, that has been used. And also that actually is a lower cost compared to the conventional soils. But however, there's some limitations of this stone column or gravel column. In this siltier material or dirty sand, the densification effectiveness gets dramatically reduced. And that soil, as I showed, this a fine grain, low plastic silt, the natural moisture content higher than its liquid limit. So that soil cannot be densified. So the stone column is less effective in that kind of a special soil. And in that soil, we typically nowadays use a soil mingling cell or soil mingling shear panels to reinforce it or mitigate it.
Thank you, Lisheng, for the answer. The next question, which way is better to mitigate the liquefaction risk? Long columns across the zone? I'm assuming the audience, he's referring to the potentially liquefiable zone. Correct me if I'm wrong. Or increase the replacement ratio. So which options is better in terms of mitigating liquefaction risks?
This is a what can I say? This is a tough question. This is related to the mechanism of the liquefaction. Ideally, we want to treat the full depths of liquefiable soil. But sometimes, if the liquefiable soil is so deep, we may be difficult to treat it. So that turns to the design challenge. If we treat it partially and leave certain kind of liquefiable soil below it, we need to run the analysis. Number one, if you leave some untreated liquefiable soil below it, below your treatment depths, you need to perform detailed analysis, hopefully find an element or find a difference analysis to make sure we don't have any bearing issues, that the untreated soil will not trigger the slope, the bearing failure, either the vertical or horizontal. Yeah. And also how to optimize the things. Personally, I want to increase this replacement ratio because a shallower liquefaction directly below the footing is the most severe, most dangerous. It will trigger this footing loss of bearing capacity and a severe settlement. So we use the kind of resources or treatment more focused to this high stress influence zone below the footing. Usually is our most cost effective, but this need be supported by your detailed analysis and make sure you have adequate bearing capacity, you have acceptable vertical and horizontal displacement in that kind of a reduced liquefaction treatment scope.
Thank you. The next question, when considering statistical approach for the strength, do you use the same correlation to the shear stiffness?
Yes. Yeah, the question is, because when we're dealing with earthquake, the earthquake theory itself is statistically based. It has a huge distributions. When we're dealing with the soil typically by layers is also quite some variable. And when we do the in situ soil mixing, past a different soil layer, we have a different type of the soil grade. Sand-based soil grade versus clay-based soil grade. when we go through the organic, it's organic-based soil creep. So that strand itself has huge variations. So designer need to consider. Need to consider this distribution and also consider its consequences. So you have a reasonable factor safety in terms of the statistics. When we analyze, it's a dynamic behavior. We usually use the average. The average design strengths, we use that in the modeling. Some of the sophisticated model, they use a Monte Carlo method. Basically, statistically, to variable this property and to see what is the consequences in terms of the displacement or factor of safety. So it is a kind of a trend, more and more geotechnical engineer to adopt this statistical based criteria. You can see from the Federal Highway Soil Mixing Guideline and also this U.S. Army Corps Soil Mixing Guideline for levees. They are all statistical based. Because for the contractor, also we want to emphasize the statistical base, because the minimum strength is very difficult to achieve, right? And when you have thousands of data points, you have one or two data points alone, the contractor still wanted to get paid. Yeah, this is has a practical reason. This kind of we need to influence the structure engineer. The structure engineer usually consider well to see what are the minimum concrete stress. But if you dig in to the details of ACI code, they also have the statistical rules. So we would like to work together with the structure engineer. And more we go to the more practical statistical based data.
Yeah. Tony, can I ask another question?
Yeah, by all means.
Yeah, we had the recent experience of planning a soil mixing project, and we had a particular relatively recent volcanic sand, and there seemed to be some sulfides in it, which reduced the normal expectations between the strength and the stiffness. So I was wondering if you had any experience with sulfides in sands causing a degradation in both stiffness and strength, but mostly in the stiffness?
Yes. Sulfate is a big factor related to cement and cement deterioration with times.
Yeah.
This has been quite intensive analyze and pay attention by the structure engineer, by the concrete industry, right? We borrowed over the theory. So in general, in my case, if I detect and know the high sulfate content, I use a type 5 type of the cement.
Mm-hmm.
Have better resistance. The directly borrowed concrete industry, the structural concrete industry. In California, because all of our native soil has quite higher sulfur content. Mm-hmm. So pretty much all of the foundation industry include the piling, foundations, concrete, and also soil mixing. We use a cement type 2/5
mm-hmm.
Intended to enhance this resistance of the sulfur attack.
Yeah. My last question is, when you do a deformation analysis with DSM, do you assume that the strength between the grids or in the grid itself, not the deep soil, not the DSM product, but the actual residual soil, do you still assume that it has a capacity or a residual strength during the liquefaction process? Because obviously there's strain compatibility issues between the DSM and the native soil. And I was wondering if you still consider that the native soil does provide some additional resistance.
Excellent question. Actually, this has been considered in the analysis, all of the analysis. This is a soil structure interaction that's in details.
Mm-hmm.
The failure strain of the soil is much higher than the failure strain of the soil grid, i.e. The peak strengths never develop at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
So in the analysis, we need to separate this characteristic. The soil property, in the material property, you have to consider it. Some people use the string softening model.
I think we've lost connection.
Yeah, seems to lost him.
Tensile stress and keep updating.
Okay, we're back.
So it is a complicated issue, but some of the people run the things conservatively. Like this Alaska job, and we just use a residual shear strength, assume soil between the shear panel fully liquefied, use a residual shear strength, and then we use the strength of the soil grid. Because when we find, when we use 50% replacement ratio, the strength in the middle, the soil strength, is not very sensitive. So conservatively, you can use a low strength in the soil. But if you want to do a more precise analysis, you can use this called a PM4 sand model developed by Peter Robinson. Developed by Ross Bollinger.
Yeah.
And consider this strength degradation during the cycle shear.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much. It was a very interesting talk. I was very interested in this case history.
Yeah, this kind of a full-size load test, I think this is the first that we encountered in North America.
Mm-hmm.
Japanese, they have more experience. They did quite a good reconnaissance after the Tohoku earthquake in 2011. They do many of the soil mixing for their port or facilities. They usually use a high replacement ratio, 50%, 80%, or even 100%. They did their reconnaissance after the earthquake and showed excellent performance. So when we're dealing with Alaska DOTs about the feasibilities of the ground improvement, we do borrow quite some of the experience and observations from Japan, Tohoku earthquake.
Mm-hmm.
So we may be more conservative because this is the first time we also use a high replacement at that time as we learn from the Japanese. So hopefully we can have more experience accumulated when more and more earthquake trigger somewhere in the world and keep learning.
Very good.
One thing I want to point out, there's a big uncertainties of the site design earthquake. Even for the same earthquake magnitude, the site response could be quite significant, even within the same city. So that variables is much better. It's much bigger than the material distributions of the soil grid. So when we design the things, we need to have a kind of overall mind to understand this input variables and also of our resistance variables.
Thank you. As a follow-up question to the previous question, in the offshore foundation industry, now they started to look at the stress they disturbed by the installation process of their anchors. So I was wondering during the analysis, the deformation modeling, are you also looking at the actual mixing process, the digging process, and maybe instead of using a geostatic stress state, and you start looking at what the impact of that disturbed stress state have on the capacity of the, let's say, a shear wall or a cutoff, slurry cutoff wall. So
this is a very good question. When we do the soil mixing, we locally create the soil stress difference.
Right.
Right after mixing, basically we dig a big hole and backfilled by this heavy fluid. This heavy fluid, like a unit weight, like a 100 to 110 pound per cubic foot, that kind of heavy fluid. And also we change the soil vertical and lateral stress, but that's all the short term. In certain case, we really need to be pay great attention. For example, if you want to do a cutoff wall or just excavation retaining wall adjacent to a high rise building, this short term stress or strength loss, you have to be considered. But typically this soil crate will gain in strength to at least to the native soil strength the next day. So within 24 hours, it will gain back to the stress. Long-termly, this kind of influence is relatively low. But short-term, if you have some shallow footings, if you have a heavily load earth, when you temporarily release the stress, it is a big concern. Yeah, I run some of the 3D finite element analysis when I research and the proposal of a cutoff wall in San Francisco, adjacent to a famous high-rise building. And there are some of the concerns we have. So we need to control the distance we position the wall versus a loaded soil.
All right, thank you for the presentation. I think that's all the questions we have for today. And again, thank you, Lisheng. This is a very interesting talk, especially for those of us in Alberta, where we have very little earthquake here. But still, so thank you.
Yeah, I did some quite some soil mixing jobs in Edmonton, mainly for the petroleum tanks under the static load. Yeah, so.
We do have induced seismicity in some places because of the fracking, oil fracking process, but.
Yeah. So it is a different task, but this kind of a soil mixing can have a lot of different applications. This seismic application is one of its use, but they have quite some other benefits.